Hi, I'm Lizzie. So contrary to what's written on the thing, I'm from biochemistry and physiology, and together with Ruan, Elliot from nutrition, and Philip Aston, we are trying to understand about what a function of our favorite protein, which is actually also depicted here on my t-shirt, so I'm going for the best dressed team member. And this protein is also here. It is a glycosylase, and it interacts with DNA, and it repairs DNA damage. We actually have this running. I will refer to it when appropriate. So why are we interested in DNA damage? So DNA damage is all the time happening in every cell of our bodies, every day. Just by living on planet Earth, we are interacting always with ultraviolet rays, and normally that's not very much of a problem in England, but today, as you see, it's very sunny, and it's been like that for a couple of times. Ionizing radiation as well. DNA damaging agents are used in the clinic for the treatment of a lot of diseases. Pollution can also be a major source of damage, and even by eating and breathing, we can also generate, through our own metabolism, we can generate damaging agents as well. So how do we actually deal with this damage? How come, since estimates say that it's 10 to thousands of damaging events that happen in every cell, every day, how come we don't just, you know, crumble and die as we step outside? And that is because we have hundreds, literally hundreds of DNA repair proteins that are working all the time in our cells. And my animation is a little bit off whack here, but what these proteins are doing, they are cutting, they are patching up, they are copying, they are doing a lot of things to the DNA, and normally they do not work alone. So they work in sequence. So one does something to the DNA that will be then used as a substrate for another enzyme on the pathway. And this is what's trying to represent here. If DNA damage is not properly repaired or not properly dealt with, so you can actually have consequences that is not a healthy smiley face cell, but is actually a mutated cell with obvious implications for cancer development. Oh, sorry about that. And you can also have a dead cell. It's very important to understand that a little bit of death, a little bit of mutation is not necessarily bad, but non-physiological levels can actually represent pathology. And a lot of diseases, such as cancer and neurodegeneration, are influenced by these factors. So what started all this was actually because I had some biological data on the effect of this glycosylase. And what I saw with a lot of my biological models was that when I did not have the DNA repair protein versus when I had the DNA repair protein, I had a very counterintuitive effect. So if there was no repair protein, the cell was smiley and alive and well. And if there was the repair protein, there was a lot of cell death. So in trying to understand why, we then decided to use some mathematical modeling to try to model the different steps in the pathway and try to understand what happens when when a lot of DNA damage is then seen by this protein, and what happens in the end, and why this cell death is going on. So now I'm going to actually pass on to whoever's going to explain the maths to you.
Thank you,
Philip.
So how do we?
I don't know
what this means. So as Lisi said, this is a multi-step sort of pathway. The one part we're not representing here is kind of cell death, where there's something kind of leaking out. So all our damaged DNA goes through these multiple stages and finally ends up nice and clear down the bottom as repaired DNA. So in this situation, and particularly in the experiments that are done often, you just introduce a fixed amount of DNA damage at the top, see how it goes through the process in order to try and understand the process. So otherwise, in the body, you might have a more of a sort of feedback loop. So we've got these multiple kind of stages. So we need to model this mathematically. So in modeling it, each stage, as we've got here, is like water flowing from one stage into the next stage. And these are all happening at different rates. So we have differential equations, which kind of model this process. Again, the end result of this process is pretty straightforward. Everything's up here will end up down there. So asymptotically, there's nothing much to say. It's the question of how it gets through that pathway, what the different kind of rates are. And we can see this stage is quite slow, so this one is building up. This one's a little bit quicker, hasn't built up so much there, and so on. So each stage is like a tap going with liquid passing from one step to the next, with the action of the enzyme moving things on to the next stage. So, but as with the tap, and as with these kind of models, so if we just have a small amount of a substance, then we get more or less linear reaction velocity, or the flow between one and the other. So if I double the amount of liquid, I double the flow rate. But ultimately, each tap, each tap has got a capacity itself. So eventually, even if I keep adding more liquid in one of the jars, the flow rate is going to tail off, but just limited by the kind of tap. This is the classic, what's called Michaelis-Menten kinetics. So that's what we're seeing for each of these stages. Then we then get a system of nonlinear differential equations. And there's quite a lot of parameters in there, so not so easy to understand. We started off looking at some data in the literature. So there's some experimental data represented by the dots on this graph. And are these on automatic? Looks like it. So it's experimental data, and another group had come and tried to fit the model based on this sort of approach to the data, and that gave this line here, and so they said, well, it doesn't give a very good fit. So they tried to estimate the parameters by searching the literature, doing experiments again to find the parameters in the model, and then ran the model and said, well, it doesn't work very well. So they said, well, we need a different model. So I started looking at this, and said, well, let's try and fit the model to the data, rather than just trying to sort of guess the parameters in advance. Can we fit the model to the data? And if we analyze this system, so basically if we look at this system, the flow rate into the bottom is really determined by the slowest step in this process. So this is the rate limiting step. So whatever happens up here doesn't matter too much. It's just this final step in this demonstration, which is the limiting one, which determines how much gets to into the bottom there. So if there's just one rate limiting step, then you can effectively model this not as a multi-step process, but as a one-step process. And just taking this and making it a one-step process, and it's only three parameters then, we actually get an excellent fit to the data, except at the beginning. And again, if we look at the theory of what's called fast-slow systems, then we can understand that. So initially, there's an initial phase when the liquid is starting to pass through and it's all settling down. But once it's settled down, then it behaves like this sort of one-step process. So Lisiane and her students then went into the lab and did lots of very hard work and lots of experiments and produced some nice data. So produce some nice data, and we tried to fit it with a sort of standard mathematical model, again trying to estimate the parameters, and the initial phase where the DNA damage is occurring seemed to fit reasonably well, but then the model just kind of shot off into outer space, didn't seem to do very well. Or if you really tried to drag this line down, you got unrealistic values of the parameters. So what's going on there? It's hard to understand. So we've put our heads together and thought, well, actually, maybe we need to change the model a little bit. So we changed the model, put different assumptions in, and then we got a very good fit to the data with the revised model. So that's about as far as you're up to now. And just a quick advertisement. So we've got a workshop in June, 26th, 27th of June. So if anyone wants to come along and learn more about this topic, you'd be very welcome. My time is gone.